Yeah. We're here with Fixing the Fourth Wall.
What's good, guys? Welcome back to another episode of Fixing the Fourth Wall, where we pick the topics we find most interesting in pop culture, politics, religion, whatever you're thinking about. We may be thinking about it too. I'm your host, Jesse Fetter.
And I'm your co-host, Alan Lane. And today's topic is representation in pop culture and entertainment in general. Booyah! And by representation, we generally mean the representation of people out of the majority. So if you're not white, you know, we love you white people too, but if we got as a majority, if you're not white, this means you. Like, how are you represented in mass media today, in pop culture?
Remember the film Top Gun? That was a big 80s film with names like Iceman, Maverick, Goose. You know the black pilot was called Sundown.
And for those of you who don't understand the importance of that topic, I want you to imagine yourself. Wake up tomorrow, and everything that's written about you is told through the lens of someone else, of a different race. And then most of those caricatures are stereotypes. Most of those stereotypes aren't very good. And every time that you try to perform or make a performance, you're typecasted into a particular role only because you're of that race, of that sexual identity, or of that gender. Now, you live that for one day. It probably sucks. I'm assuming you would be correct. That's what people of color and women and people of different sexual orientation have been dealing with their entire fucking lives.
Oh my god!
Like, that's it. It's not really told through the lens of the people who we aim to represent. Like, if you're a black guy, most often than not, you're not a dynamic character. Usually you're the villain.
King Kong ain't got shit on me!
And it has a tone, and it speaks volumes in how society views, especially black men.
For instance, giving examples, when's the last time you saw a black scientist? Black valedictorian? And now I'm specifying with males, when's the last time you saw with black females not typecasted as being angry, or poor, or uneducated,
or being a single mother?
It's always very, it goes off of the stereotypes. The typecasting mirrors the stereotypes in today's society, particularly with American society, United States culture. It's very rare that we see a very educated or a type of black character that doesn't fit the stereotypical molds. And even to a different extent, with Asian characters too, or other minorities such as, you know, brown people, either Latino or people from the Middle East. You'll see recently with Christian Bale of Exodus, the Egyptian movie that was taking off of the story of Moses.
Yeah.
It was completely whitewashed.
I have been told that things here have become much worse.
Same thing with that movie with all the Egyptian gods. How are all the Egyptian gods white people?
Whatever you will, mountains will kneel before you, the winds will do your bidding.
Back then, you know, it's been historically theorized and backed, their arguments have been substantiated. Many scholars have found that in the Middle East, Anglo-Saxonism was pretty much nearly non-existent. We really didn't start seeing in history the first elements of Anglo-Saxonism until like the 7th and 8th century. What we know as today as Western modern Europe. You saw it in Nordic countries. Mm. You also started to see it in the regions where England and France reside. but Anglo-Saxonism wasn't that prevalent back in biblical times. And that goes to also a greater point with Alan and I's topic with representation in entertainment and pop culture in general. The landscape has been so dominated by white actors and actresses, white characters, that there's more flexibility and diversity of positions and roles that white characters will receive as opposed to their minority counterparts.
Exactly. One of the things that you have to realize is there's nothing against people who are not of color, people who are white, like, you know, having diverse roles. It's more so people just want the equality. Black people, people of color, we're diverse too. Not every black person or every Asian person or every gay person is the same. There's so many differences unique within different communities that have yet to be failed to be represented. I mean, now we're getting to a point where more things are, there's representation, but like even when there is, there's this crazy amount of backlash where people flip the fuck out for no reason. Like, oh my God, this character's black. And the thing is, unless the character's racial identity is key to their character components, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, and the reason there's backlash is, historically speaking, in not just cinema, but also in comics and in animation, any type of entertainment, we have been programmed over decades to accept a certain way, where more times than not, a white character will always be epitomized as being good, righteous, morally sound, educated.
Here to save us all.
Pretty much the savior, where a lot of not just black actors, but Latino actors and actresses, Latino characters, black characters, whether the very few times we see Native American characters, they're always in need of some type of intervention by a white character. They're seen as helpless, they're seen as dependent, they're seen as lacking sophistication. And since we've been accustomed to that for so long, that's one of the reasons why we don't have that backlash.
Want answers.
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
For instance, recently, the Luke Cage series. Luke Cage is a character, for those of you who don't know, in Marvel. There's a Luke Cage series on Netflix.
Great series, by the way. Definitely check it out.
Very phenomenal series. I've seen a few episodes, just had a kind of a, you know, mental fart there. But that series follows the actual material, the comic material, extraordinarily faithfully, more so than most other shows currently on television, more so than Jessica Jones, more so than Supergirl, even The Flash.
There are a few key differences, but most of those twists are because, I mean, when Luke Cage came out, it was the 70s, and so they've updated it to a more 2000 modern version. Those are the differences that are like exist, and that's just because, well, you have to adjust it for the times.
And aside from that, getting back to, you know, talking about Luke Cage, even though that series has been faithfully following the comic material, there's been a backlash by a certain segment of comic book fans who have been accustomed, as we've been saying, for decades to, you know, white heroism, that the series, Luke Cage series, is quote-unquote too black.
Aw, you gotta be fucking kidding me!
Now, first of all, before we go into what it means to be too black, when you have in movies a lot of whitewashing of history, and there's not much really talked about from not just the white community, but a little bit of sometimes silence from other minority communities too, begrudgingly accepting it. When does it become a problem when a show is actually faithfully following the comics, but because it's focusing on a minority group or a minority character following a certain way of the subculture of that minority group, when does it really become an issue? And why does it become an issue? would you rather have accuracy but not have a white character as the face of the franchise, or would you rather have a bunch of white characters in whether it be comics and film, but also have historically speaking inaccuracies and also not ideological inaccuracies, religious inaccuracies, like I said, huge historical inaccuracies. Where do you find that balance? We have to have a certain type of consistency, and there's a certain type of inconsistency in approaching minority groups represented in film or comics versus white, Anglo-Saxonist, Caucasian groups in pop culture.
And one, it's not just, you know, Luke Cage, another example, but back in 2012, The Hunger Games came out. Great series of movies. Jennifer Lawrence did a great job.
Phenomenal.
But the first backlash I heard, besides that, you know, a lot of things are picking up in the quote-unquote Twitterverse, was so many people were angry, like vehemently angry at the fact that two popular characters, Cinna and Rue, were black or dark-skinned. And they, you know, not protested, but they complained about it to no extent. And the irony is, you could tell their passion came from the fact that they wanted the characters to remain consistent with what they read in the book. But the problem was, a lot of people had this idea that these characters in their head were white. And when that didn't match up to the reality of the characters, they kind of were upset. But the thing is, if you read the books, it was a post-apocalyptic world where people were race mixing going around, and they were described as having dark olive skin with curly hair. Well, Lenny Kravitz literally has dark olive skin with curly hair, like half black, half white. I don't know what people thought was going to happen.
And other examples, as we've seen, with a lot of Latino women. How many times do you see a lot of Latino women kind of, pushed to being maids in film?
Hola?
Yes, could you please put Brian back on?
No, doggy afuera.
You're the new housekeeper, aren't you?
Si.
Listen, I don't want to point fingers, but I'm missing about $1,000 in play money.
I take.
What, you took it?
Si.
We'll give it back.
Come get, bitch.
How many times you see Asian actors always having to follow the stereotype of being mathematically gifted or martial arts driven? It's always that type of stereotyping, that typecasting, which follows the stereotypes. And beyond minority groups, when it comes to ethnicity or color, we also have to talk about gender.
Woo!
Alan mentioned about Hunger Games. You know, some, even though it followed faithfully, some people had a problem with a female lead. What about in the most recent film with Rogue One? Star Wars Rogue One, which, by the way,
we're about to go see.
Exactly. Gonna be epic. People were having a problem with that female lead, even though the original Star Wars film had Carrie Fisher, Princess Leia, as one of the leads.
And I think the people's problem with it was, I guess their dynamic was, this Carrie Fisher was a part of a threesome. Ha ha, pun no. But you know, it was Harrison Ford and Carrie Fisher, Luke Skywalker, all the three characters. She was just a part of the three. She split it. This is like the central figure in Star Wars right now. It's a girl. And there's nothing wrong with it. It's just, she's a character. It's Rogue One. We're at a point in history where more people have to be represented. And if it's all guys doing shit, I'm sorry, that's not how history works. Even though we make sure that it's mostly guys are popular, if women didn't exist, none of us would be here. Sorry, they have a lot of important roles too.
Mark Hamill.
Yes.
Because Luke Skywalker didn't do the goddamn Joker voices. That would actually be pretty epic. But we'll get to that. We'll explore that another time.
Take my blood, for example.
I wish somebody would.
This stuff is killing me.
Why should I care?
Because now there's a teeny little bit of me in you too, bats.
And besides gender, there's also sexual orientation as well. That's a very important one. For instance, the latest Spider-Man with Miles Morales, who's seen as a half-Latino, half-black character who is hinted at being bisexual. People not only had a problem, some people, I can't generalize, but as I was saying, certain people had a problem not only with him being mixed, but also with him not being straight. And that's the image that we've really become, you know, accustomed to, programmed to. We've been driven over and over to see a white, straight, educated male that happens to be always the missing piece in a series or a hurricane of a shitstorm of problems.
One of the things that, you know, I'm sure people in the LGBTQ community can attest to is not only being marginalized, as they often are, and being ridiculed, is especially how gay men are normally viewed. They're so flamboyant.
Can I show you a picture and then you tell me if it's good for Facebook?
Okay, I'm fairly certain you're going to show me something overtly sexual.
Don't you prejudge me!
Here it is.
Ah! That's a close-up of an anus.
Oh, no, that's not an anus. That's my anus, baby girl.
And there's nothing wrong with flamboyancy. It's like, if that's part of your personality, but we have this stereotype. That's what we expect all gay men to be. And that's not... you know, I have a lot of friends who are, you know, gay, and there's some guys, it just doesn't, that stereotype, so many people, that stereotype doesn't apply to them.
Right. I met quite a few masculine gay men as well. I have a couple friends that, you know, for instance, activities that are usually associated with being masculine. Another topic we'll get to another time, you know, what is masculine, what is feminine. But anyway, activities such as hunting, going to the range and shooting, as well as typically maybe certain sports, or you also had working out, you know, working with weights and whatnot. These men would do this on the regular. And the way, I wouldn't say Hollywood, but in pop culture in general, views gay men is being, you have to be like, instead of flamboyant, you have to be somebody that likes to shop, that likes, you know, looks for clothes,
great at interior design,
bright colors, interior design.
They like to make entrances.
Have you people lost your minds? You cannot do this.
Why not? We're fine with it.
It's not about you being fine with it. It's about Justin being fine with it. Really? You know, I expected you to know better.
Why do I always have to know better?
Thanks. Thank you. You saved my life. Would you listen to the man? Come on. He's an expert.
A man, you know, that always talks with a lisp or some type of high-pitched accent, over-the-top, bubbly, always happy, positive. Extraordinarily, I don't want to say the words feminine, because at this point, what do we consider masculine and feminine? Again, another topic for another time.
I'll count you on it.
But what he's testing to is there's these visions that we have. Gay people, I'm sorry, gay men aren't just walking around in the field picking daisies all day. It's not what they're doing. You know, they have their dynamic is just as you and I are.
And, you know, we have to find a way not only to break these typecasted roles, but to open a new avenue for a whole variety of people, bring new perspectives. We're not trying to, we don't need to force people's ways of lives on you, but more represent what reality is. Because right now, even though we see in comics and movies, all different types of pop culture, even though it's fantasy, it's fiction, a lot of it, it still is masking multiple segments of the population that we could get different perspectives of, that could bring more to the table.
I mean, the thing is, you know, when people talk about representation, representation isn't forcing people to see things that, you know, aren't there. It's like, you know, people being gay, they're there. People being, you know, black and educated and super nerdy, they exist. They're not just figments of your imagination. You just haven't been, they haven't been represented in the media, so you know, a lot of people aren't aware of them. I mean, I have to give credit where credit's due of, obviously, it's Modern Family. It's great sitcom, and I don't even like sitcoms, but Modern Family does a great job of representing people in such a dynamic way. Even there's like one episode where the little girl went to a doctor, and her two gay dads are trying to talk to their Asian doctor, and she's like, is that not appropriate? And like, you know,
in Modern Family?
Yeah. It's like, that's not appropriate in Chinese culture? She's like, I don't know. I grew up in Michigan.
But yeah, anyway, guys, we just wanted you to maybe ponder upon that. And if you have any comments or any extra thoughts to add, put them in the comments below. And that's it for this episode. We're going to conclude.
And if you guys like our show and want to talk about it, I think the best sign of affection that you can give us is share us online, you know, comment on our YouTube channel, and just bring the joy of fixing the fourth wall to everyone around you.
And as one of the internet personalities that I follow, Barack Obama, says, smash that motherfucking like button as well as subscribe. Anyway, guys, once again, I'm your host, Jesse Fetter.
And I am Alan Lane.
And we are Instant Transmitting Out.
Hopeless sinners who have